So I've had this idea about hanging some of my grinders up. Obviously, you have grinders with wheels on them to do different things. Some of the guys on a forum I belong to have been posting different types of tool hangers, vice grips, that kind of sort. So I've been thinking about a grinder design, and I've kind of laid it out the way I think it will look when it's all folded up. We're gonna cut one out and give it a whirl. So this is the first step, is getting it drawn and getting the cut file. If you look at the image, you can see kind of a double line. Well, one is the actual drawing. The one outside of that is the actual cut line, because you've got a kerf, so you've got to offset the original drawing by whatever you think the kerf is. Like right now, I know it's running about 50 thousandths, so you're 25 thousandths off the line, which you plug all that info in before you generate the cut file, and it does all that automatically. So we'll get it over on the machine and we'll give it a whirl. All right, you're probably gonna hear a couple noises in the background. I've got an air dryer that bleeds off air all the time. Once I start cutting, I'll turn on a fan. I have what they call a downdraft table, where I've closed it all in around the legs. Squirrel cage blower tied into that, just pulling air down through the grate and out of the building. That eliminates all that fine plasma dust, which is basically melted metal particles, and they go everywhere. So we try to get those right out as we're cutting. All right, I'm gonna initiate the cut. We'll see how it goes. I have it set to pause between cuts. So I basically push the start button every time the machine has located to the right position and a part hasn't popped up so that it won't catch it. Whoops, I forgot to turn on the blower. Cut. You can see we're running really close to that far edge. I'm actually surprised that the port stayed lit, because it has a voltage sensing nozzle on it, and once you go off the grate, it loses that communication with the software, so it'll usually stop. But I must have been right close enough so that it kept the arc initiated. So now the next step is get it over on the table and hit it on both sides of the flap wheel. We'll do that, and we'll continue along, and we'll get it into the brake where we actually fold it up into its final shape. All right, now we're gonna clean it up with the flap wheel. The camera will probably pick up the noise pretty good, but we'll see what we can do about editing it after. All All right, there's the slag. What little slag there is on it has been knocked off. And I basically use just a flap wheel and a grinder. They have some give to it versus a hard stone. You can feather stuff a lot nicer with this. And they last quite a while. They are expensive, but they last. So if you buy good ones. All right, here's an old brake. It's a small brake, but it's quite old. Guy gave me this, thought it was broken. Because these rollers here, this actually will separate without having to take anything apart. And I believe it was designed that way. Because you can adjust, you have to adjust here for the thickness of metal. So it when you form in that right angle, there has to be room for that corner to form inside. So you can raise this bed up and down, and I believe that's what that cam is for. So we just take the piece. Put it in the brake, maybe. Line it up with the line that I cut. Which all that does is make it easier to bend. Roll it up to what you think is 90 degrees. I'll check it with the square. See, that one actually went a bit too far, but because all this has been cut away, you basically are just bending here on the corners. You can finesse it with your hand. All right, so we're gonna make our second bend. Bend that up. Again, it's all by eye, basically. And I'll check it with the square. Because if I need to address that 90, it has to be done before the next bend. Otherwise, I won't be able to get it back in the machine. So here, we're bending up the first leg. Again, going to 90. So that's the shape so far. Our last bend, this is where it gets a little tight. All right, so that's basically the profile we're looking at. And again, I can finesse it some if I need to. Those are pretty good. This one has to go in a little bit. That one is pretty good. So there's two sets of holes. There is this set here, which actually would be screwed to the wall. This is the wall surface on this side. These other holes are just so you can get a screwdriver or bit driver through to drive them screws in. At first I didn't have that in the design. And it made very difficult to get a screw in along here. So just added the second set of holes. And then I can put a bit right through there and drive the screw. So made it much easier. So that's basically the finished product. Screw it on the wall, hang your grinder in, which I'll show you in a minute. And we're pretty much wrapped up. So this is basically how the thing will work. You screw that onto your wall. Say like this. You can see it. Can't be on both sides of the camera at the same time. And you hang your grinder just like that. It just keeps them out of the way. keeps them from hitting the ground, especially with a, if you've got a grinding disc on them, a real stone, you drop it, you chip it or crack it, next time you fire up that grinder, probably got pieces going everywhere. So, simple design, and sometimes simple is best. It works really well. Thanks for watching.